52%.
The show that explores everything and anything going on in Liverpool and beyond from the perspective of 52% of the population, women.
I'm Jennifer Jewell.
And I'm Lisa Simmons. And this week we're celebrating the incredible and diverse events that are going on in our city this year.
From the Three Queens and Sound City to the Basilica Carnival and the Arab Arts Festival, here's what's coming up on today's show. Now by Cathy Lawrence from the Boudoir Book and Jacquie Johnston-Lynch, who is the brains behind The Brink on Parr Street and manager of an organisation doing wonderful work, Tom Harrison House. Ladies, thank you so much for joining us. Jacquie, first of all, I do want to ask you, tell us how you got involved in The Brink and this new organisation you're doing now, because you've done some fantastic things.
Well, The Brink was born out of the idea that Liverpool needed something that was a bit less controversial, as in the sense of we were top of the league for admissions to hospital for binge drinking. So we thought, well, we could do with something in our kind of social side of town that didn't serve any alcohol. So a place where you could go and have a great night out, but wake up the next morning with only sore feet, but not a sore head. So it was kind of born out of the need for that, really. And also my personal experience is that a lot of addiction and alcoholism in my family, and my brother was killed by a drunk driver. So okay. The idea being that The Brink would be a place where people could actually go and socialise, but still pick up the keys and drive safely home.
So it's quite personal to you, wasn't it? And you're now involved in a new charity, so tell us all about that.
Yeah, Tom Harrison House, again, it features around addiction and alcoholism, but this time it's treating addiction and alcoholism for military veterans. Often veterans go out and face combat, or they face long periods of time away, and then they've maybe given 8, 9, 22 years of their lives to the armed forces, but they come back and don't feel part of anymore, don't feel like they belong, and they may have some kind of quite stressful symptoms and mental health disorders that they tend to medicate with alcohol. So some of them get quite addicted quite quickly, so we're working solely with veterans now to treat their addiction.
Fantastic.
Brilliant.
Now we are talking about events today going on in the city. Cathy, I'm sure you're a massive fan of the events that go on in the city. Did any in particular stand out to you, and what you do?
Well, the one that always stands out to me every year is the Arab Arts Festival. It's something that I find fascinating. I used to do the Middle Eastern dancing some years ago.
Can you give us a demonstration?
If you've got the music ready, yeah.
No.
I used to be a student of Middle Eastern dance. I eventually became a teacher, but from that I got interested in Middle Eastern music and the culture. And as a result, I'm the Arab Arts Festival is always a favourite of mine.
Liverpool's such a diverse and cultural city, though. We cover, we've got Basilica coming up.
Yes,
amazing. Africa Oye. There's so many festivals that we are fortunate to have on our doorstep.
And we are going to be talking about all of them today, aren't we?
Can't wait.
Yes. Jacquie, have you got a personal favourite festival?
Yeah, like Cathy, kind of Liverpool Arab Arts Festival is one of mine. And this week, the last weekend, was the launch with the Family Day, and it was like record numbers went through for the Family Day, which was incredible. I also like Brouhaha and Africa Oye. You know, they're just fantastic events, really.
Amazing. Now, more about your charity, but there are obviously pros and cons to doing what you do, and it can't be easy. What would you say the pros and cons are? I'm sure you get a lot of benefit from it.
Yeah, well, me personally, I love what I do. I think that there's, and particularly for women, that we find a lot of meaning in life. We place more value in the jobs and the roles that we do. So for me, I think the whole phrase turning pain into purpose is really significant. And I think that if there have been painful moments in people's lives, if you can turn that into something quite purposeful,
yeah,
then it can really change things around for yourself and for lots of other people. So for me, I work hard, play hard, and have really good times with my family. And I think it's really important to have a good work-life balance in the mix too.
And what about the tough parts of it? Because I'm sure you must see some hard things.
Yeah, we do. We see some incredibly sad things. Mm-hmm. Yesterday was a big day for us. We saw quite a sad situation yesterday in work. And for us, I think that what we've got at work is a really good, small but close-knit team. So we come together and we discuss everything, we share our feelings. As long as not we're not weeping over the people that we're working with, we can shut the door in the office and have a little cry and kind of wipe our tears and then back out to work. And we do, and we pull together great, you know.
I really admire that. I'd find that so, you know, me, tiny tears.
I should cry at the slightest thing. You wouldn't be so good doing what Jacquie does.
I admire what you do. Enormously, I think it's fantastic that there's something there for people to turn to in you know, times of need.
Of course. But there are
all of what you're saying that your phrase of turning pain into purpose. That's really something.
And we do have a lot of festivals that do engage. There's so much for people in the city, isn't there, at the moment, for anything really.
Yeah, my little boy, he's 12, and he's taken part in Africa Oye, and he's got Asperger's, but he goes to a kind of dance and drama class that has mixed ability in there, so he really enjoys that. He knows he's not great at various things, but he loves it, he's passionate about it, and is getting the opportunity to perform in Africa Oye, which I just think is incredible, to be able to just involve the local public. It's fantastic.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? I think people think to go and watch these carnivals, you have to be great, or you have to be so, but it's about taking part that makes people feel good, isn't
absolutely.
It?
Absolutely. I've danced at the Unity a couple of times as part of the Arab Dance Showcase that is often held during the festival. And, you know, I'm just a girl from Heighton originally, you know. I'm not from Cairo or anywhere. But it was lovely to feel part of it and to actually participate as well as attend the other events
the
going on.
It comes through, doesn't it? So when you're there and you just, the adrenaline kicks in, you're just having a really good time. And ultimately, isn't that what it's about?
I think having a
really good time.
Absolutely, yes. I mean, you think back in my day, there was nothing. I mean, you know, thinking of festivals then, my brothers would go to maybe Nebworth or, you know, Glastonbury, but that'd be about it.
Absolutely, I know. We'll chat a bit more about that. You both ladies mentioned the Arab Arts Festival. Now, one of the wonderful events going on in the city right now is the Arab Arts Festival, which is running until Sunday. Gail headed over to the festival earlier this week to find out what it's all about.
That's right, the Liverpool Arab Arts Festival has been on since last week, and while events are happening all over the city, I'm at the Blue Coat today for a symposium all about women, and particularly the challenges women from Arab cultures are facing in the world. I've had a chat with Rachel Gaston, award-winning artist whose work links creativity and disability, as well as Nazir Afzal, former Chief Crown Prosecutor for the Northwest of England, who's been invited to the event.
I am delighted to be able to chair the Liverpool Arab Arts Festival Symposium today. This focuses on women and women's roles in society, particularly in the Arab cultures. There are serious concerns about how Arab women are being dealt with and treated, how their rights are being supported. And what we want to be able to do today is firstly understand the challenges that Arab women face, not just in the Arab parts of the world, but also here in the United Kingdom. And then look at what solutions might be available in terms of being able to empower women, to give them the ability to tackle the challenges that they face, to ensure that we have equality of rights, not just in the United Kingdom, but across the world.
And how do you intend to do that? I mean, today the symposium, is there going to be an exchange with the people in the audience as well?
The audience, we hope, will be made up of many people from different cultures. And there's no community in this world where women and girls are safe. So we want to understand what good practice there is in this country, what good practice there is in the Middle East. At the same time, we want to understand what isn't working, and then perhaps identify solutions.
Okay. Because you're a strong advocate, yes, of women's rights. You've done a lot for that. How, on the practical level, how can we do that?
The biggest concern I have is that throughout the world, we're not giving women and girls the rights they deserve. There are so many communities where boys are seen as a blessing, girls are seen as a burden. And what we have to ensure is that that doesn't happen in the future. We, as a society, have to modernize, we have to advance, and we can only do that by educating young people, by not denying women their rights and the girls their rights. And I hope
that by sharing good practice, you know, we've learned a great deal in the United Kingdom about how women and girls are being treated and what we can do to prevent the harm that they suffer. But we can learn from other parts of the world, but at the same time, we can help other parts of the world. And I think that this is part of the process, having this discussion today with some eminent speakers who have phenomenal knowledge, at the same time, tremendous experience. We hope that we can share good practice, we can learn from each other, and that we can share that throughout the world.
I create cross-cultural projects that involve Middle East and UK audiences addressing issues around disability and diversity.
Why did you decide to, I mean, why do you work on this theme in particular? Is it like from a personal point of view?
I've actually been disabled all of my life. I have a lung condition and I'm also visually impaired, but I grew up in the Middle East. And so the Middle East territory is really where my soul is. And I'm very interested in addressing these issues to make sure that disability is open and public and that all young people can lead the most fulfilling lives with or without a disability. I'm actually a painter and drawer, and all of my projects that I create embrace other communities. And part of that process means unless you understand other people, you can't make work about other people. So I make sure that all my projects are collaborative and that people have the opportunity to have their own voice through creativity. And that way we find that it becomes a universal story. It's not just my story. And it's about sharing stories, vulnerability, survival, hope, all of those issues. What you tend to find with any difficult issues, and disability is a difficult issue within Muslim communities, and what tends to happen is what you can't address through politics, you can address through cultural values. It becomes much easier. One of the reasons I was most interested to take part in this particular symposium, I try and build all my projects so that they're led by women. It makes it easier within the Muslim community to be able to be open if the projects are led by women. It's easier for the women, and also the men are fine about it. So obviously this is really important for me.
Welcome back. So before the break, we took a look at what was going on over at the Arab Arts Festival, which is at the Blue Coat this week. It was, yeah, it's really interesting. And
was it what you expected?
Well, do you know what? I think the Middle East gets such bad press with Syria, so it was lovely to have that contrast.
Well, because there's so much positive that comes from their culture, isn't it? That sometimes you can hear the negative. But you ladies have both attended the Arab Arts Festival in the past. How did you find it was for the female Arabic women?
Just touching again on what Lisa was saying, it's the bridge between the Western culture and the Middle Eastern culture, and people starting to have a mutual understanding that really makes the difference for me and for the people I've known who've come in to, you know, the Arab Arts Festival, not really understanding what things are about, and left with a greater understanding and feeling more at ease within those communities.
And I
think that can only ever be a good thing.
Jacquie, how did you find the Arab Arts Festival? And what was the atmosphere like, and what were they trying to promote there?
Yeah, I think it's always been really upbeat. Lots of fantastic events. I mean, the team of organisers, you know, you think it's only a once a year event, but actually what happens during this week takes a year to organise. Wow. They work so hard. And the range of guest speakers that they bring in, the range of film in particular, the FACT hosts a lot of the films that take place during the festival. The range of film is incredible, the things that you wouldn't normally get to see outside of world cinema. So for me, it's absolutely fantastic. I love the way it bridges the audiences. That's what's really important. Seeing lots of different people going in to Blue Coat, seeing lots of different people going in to watch cinema at FACT. So I really like that. My parents lived in the Middle East for about 10 years, so I used to travel out to the Middle East quite a bit. So they lived in Dubai, Oman and Doha.
Oh, right.
Yeah, okay. So I kind of lived out there, learned a little bit of the language, and now I've got big Arabic tattoo on the back of the neck.
Oh, lovely. What does that mean?
the tattoo says, if not now, when? Okay. So meaning to have purpose. If you're not going to do it now, be clear about when you might focus down and do it.
Brilliant. Tomorrow never comes, does it?
Exactly. Full of sayings now, aren't we? Yeah. But no, one thing I noticed about that video, which I loved, is they were saying the way it brings people together. That's what a festival surely is about, isn't it? Bringing people of all walks of life, because it's not
and
just Arabic
cultures.
People. Yeah, yeah, of course, you're invited to this festival, but it brings people together. Is that the main point of a festival, do you think?
Well, the main point of a festival is to be festive. So it's to have a good time, isn't it? But, you know, there are lots of knock-on effects from having that good time. People come along with the aim of, oh, I'm going to relax, have a great time at this thing. But it's through that they might attend workshops or they might attend, you know, films or whatever. And they will be educated without even realising it.
Educated by having fun.
Yeah, and it's changing your perception, because I would assume with this kind of festival, you go in with one idea in your mind, but then you'd like to think that you'd leave completely educated. Your perception of that culture has changed, hopefully for the better.
I'm sure.
With a lot of the festivals that happen, a festival doesn't have to be just Creamfields.
Oh, no.
Another huge festival. Everyone loves the music. But something like that, and, you know, we've touched about Africa Oye as well. Yeah. That's going to open your mind to that culture, isn't it?
Is it good to take kids along to these things, do you think, and open their minds to other cultures?
Yeah, absolutely. I think having kind of kid-focused friendly events really great at cultural events as well, because kids are really eager. Like, we sometimes lose our passion as we're getting older. We might lose a passion, lose our curiosity, but kids are really curious. First thing my little boy wants to do when he gets on holiday is to learn to say hello and goodbye in that language, you know. And I think it's like really important that kids stay curious and we nurture that in them, particularly about other cultures.
But my favorite thing from that video, I have to say, was the way they said they have the females leading the creativity teams, because they find out it makes it easier for the other females, and also the men are quite receptive to it. That's a very interesting point, isn't it? Do you think that females do lead that type of thing a little better?
I think that we've got a different way about us. Yeah. So we're less antagonistic, less bolshy, maybe, and able to do a lot of collaboration rather than competition and setting people up against each other. I think we're women in particular are much more able to do collaboration, and I think in projects like that, as Rachel the artist said, you need to understand other people's stories in order to be able to tell them. So I think it's important to collaborate in situations like that.
So yeah, get down to the Arab Arts Festival this weekend.
Will
you be going?
Sunday, doesn't it?
It does, yeah. I'm very interested actually after watching that. I do think I want to pop down and have a look, so we might plan
see what
that.
It's all about.
Yeah, is it time for What's Trending?
I think so.
Go on then, you can start off What's Trending. What's been trending this week, Lise?
Well, we talk about the this particular family quite a lot, but Caitlyn Jenner.
Okay.
Out there.
Bruce Jenner is now Caitlyn Jenner.
Yeah.
Well, the story's been going for a while, hasn't it? And it's been pretty much step-by-step revelation. People speculated he was going to be...
Did the media have done that?
No, I think it's them, to be totally honest.
That's what I mean, the media then.
Oh, yeah. I think they've revealed different details step-by-step. Yeah. Well, it's now been revealed that he's going to do a reality series as well. Should I say? Yeah. So what have you made of the whole revelation of the name now?
Well, to me, it's...
I don't think I've ever seen you dumbstruck.
No, exactly. I do feel a bit ambivalent about this. I think it's fabulous, and I rejoice in the fact that, you know, if somebody doesn't feel comfortable within the gender that they were born with, that they can have their gender reassigned and that can be celebrated. But then again, I'm thinking about the amount of money that Caitlin had and was able to do this and have all the support. Is it the same for the average person in the street here? I don't think it is. So on the one hand, I'm thinking, isn't it great? It's putting this information out there for people. But on the other hand, I'm thinking it's not so easy for the average person.
I think also
on the
a lot of people look at the Kardashian brand as a
the
whole
empire.
And think it's purely for entertainment. So
yeah.
I think brand is the right word to use
well,
as
they
well.
Are, yeah. They've, yeah. they've built this brand and she is now a part of this brand and now going to have their own reality series. Is that making people take it seriously as they should, do you think, Jacquie?
I think probably that's where there's kind of like a flaw in this whole process is that I think it's incredible, you know, now that Caitlin is out there, and it's a really courageous thing to do, a really important and significant thing to do. But because it's tied up in that whole brand and stuff, that's where I think there are going to be people who kind of dismiss it, ridicule it, because it's part of the whole kind of keeping up with the Kardashians. Bruce Jenner has an incredible story to tell. Caitlyn is now going to continue that story and make the world take notice. I think the person who's kind of said it the best is Jon Stewart from The Daily Programme.
Yes.
And he's if you Google it and you'll see it on YouTube, you'll see... the whole kind of piece that he's done about kind of welcome to America as a woman and the sexism that now Caitlin will now experience.
Yeah.
So it's
a different spin on it.
Yeah. Definitely a whole new
Let's
reality.
Let's leave them anyway. We talk about them loads, don't we?
Yeah, we
what
do.
About Kate Moss getting thrown off a plane, please, on EasyJet? Supermodel on an EasyJet. Who's
like
a thunk?
I'm a fan of that. I think I like that she's travelling
slumming
class
it with the rest of
she's
us.
She's not thinking she has to travel first class.
Yeah.
How she
do first class.
Of course, yeah. How she acted, though, I'm not sure that that's very appropriate. However, I'm not surprised. Kate Moss is always the type of character who's going to be in the press for wrong reasons, but it's always going to help her, isn't it? Yeah.
She's been quiet for a while, though, hasn't she?
Yeah, it seems to be since her marriage. I mean, she does seem to have settled down, but, yeah. I mean, I can't help but I want to have a little pun, you know, but she was on the plane. Did she snap?
Sorry. it's almost though you can be forgiven for taking it out of context. Maybe she wasn't that bad. I mean, the media can turn a story from a small thing into a major thing.
None of us really know what happened on the plane, do we? But you know, it's she's Kate Moss and she makes great coverage, doesn't she?
Exactly. Well, as Kate Moss, that's the key. I think there's a fantastic media person in the comms department at EasyJet, and they promoted this. You know, how many people get off a plane a little bit worse for wear, or have had fun chatty on the plane? So it happens to so many people. But I think some person in comms has picked this up and ran with it, and it's a great piece of publicity for EasyJet.
I know somebody who was arrested on a plane for laughing too much.
Really?
She doesn't even drink.
Oh, wow.
She doesn't even drink. She just has
like
this laugh that doesn't stop. And people complained, and so she was arrested and taken off.
Oh, that's awful.
It does make you wonder.
Talking about PR, some bad PR, Alton Towers. Oh, horrific. Yes.
Mm. Awful, horrific. Awful story, isn't it? I mean,
so sad.
When I first saw it, you just almost can't believe it because you put so much trust. Of course, a lot of people are afraid of theme parks and they're in two minds to go anyway. These people have gone, putting their faith in. They've been...
Fun day out.
Now this poor young lady's lost a leg.
Yeah. 17, isn't she?
Would it put you off going to Alton Towers now?
Well, it's made me worried because both of my boys have their end of year trip to Alton Towers this year.
Yeah.
And
do you want them to go now, or are they getting called off? What are the schools?
No,
the schools calling it off?
It's still there. They're still able to go. I don't like them being out of my sight. Yeah. I hate them going to the fair. I'm scared of the fair.
I love things like that. I love theme parks. I love rides, but. That has kind of even made me, who's not bothered about them at all, feel like
they've got to
shut that
ride down.
Well,
surely,
at the moment, it's not.
I mean,
you
know, demolish it or whatever, because there's been a few things on that ride,
really?
Hasn't there? I think it was. Yeah, it's been shut a few times. I've got the number five in my head. I think it's
five
been.
Times.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah. So I think it's time to.
But there was a problem with the emergency services as well, wasn't there? In terms of the fire crew, taking 30 minutes to get there because of cuts and things, procedures have changed, and the call out sort of route that it's taken takes far longer now, so there's that to consider too.
Well, fair play to our emergency service when they got there. They did what they had to do.
Absolutely.
The helicopters were in, that, you know, the children were taken away.
Simply not good enough for Alton Towers, there isn't. I'm sure that there'll be a lot of backlash from that. So join us after the break anyway for more chat about our festivals in our city and everything that's coming up. So see you after the break for more 52%.
Welcome back. So in today's show, we've been talking about the amazing events that happen in our city, the best city in the world, Liverpool.
Yes, another one that is coming up next weekend is Africa Oye, which is an African music festival in Sefton Park. Gail spoke to the organiser of the festival to get a sneak preview.
I'm now with Paul Dwayne. You're the artistic director of Africa Oye.
Right.
The festival has been going on for 23 years.
Yes.
It's quite a lot.
It is. It's you know, quite amazing that we've been going for that long. I mean, when it first started, it was not like it is now. It started off like small gigs around the city centre. And then it was in Princess Park and then Concert Square and Birkenhead Park. So until it's found its natural home in Sefton Park, probably over 10 years ago now.
Okay. And how do you make it different each year? How do you make sure that there is something new all the time?
Because it's a free festival, you know, we don't have a massive budget to work with. We have to be really careful about what we introduce and really clever, think of clever ways of how to do it. And, you know, there's a lot of people in Liverpool, a lot of local organisations that like to showcase what they do at the festival, and then they can come into it to help you know, create these new areas. Like 2 years ago, we had an area created called Trench Town, which houses DJs. And that was a real new element to the festival because it was always only one live stage, everything going on that one stage, all the focus on that. But as time has gone on, we always thought that we have to make new additions so that everybody can feel included, you know. Like, mm-hmm. obviously, children are not going to want to sit there and listen to live music all day because they've got a lower attention span. So mm-hmm. we should try and have activities like workshops going on that are free. To attend. Also, we have, you know, fun fairs and stuff like that, which are obviously not free, but you know, that's to be expected. Yeah. And then obviously the traders that we have now, we started off, I think, when we first moved into Sefton Park, we had maybe four traders, and now we've got, you know, 80 or 90, wow. you know, so that's something that's just grown. And I think everything grows naturally as well. The audience has grown, mm-hmm. so everything that we do grows with it, you know.
Great. And I was wondering as well, you know, the fact that there are many festivals in Liverpool celebrating the diverse cultures. I'm thinking of Chinese New Year, Brasilica, the Arab Arts Festival that is going on right now. Africa Oye, how do you, what's the impact on the community that it has?
I think it's, you know, definitely has an impact on the community. I think what's great about Sefton Park is where it's situated, it's kind of in the middle of every type of community, so the upshot of that is the audience represents that, and it's particularly, you know, close to my heart that the black community feels involved and they embrace it and they look forward to it every year as their kind of event. I mean, we're an international music festival, but we very much care about, you know, our local people from the black community and from all the other communities in Liverpool. We just want a big melting pot of people all in one place having a good time.
And every year you have like a lot of big personality coming to the festival. I was wondering as well, there's lots of African people coming. This morning I was at the Liverpool Arab Arts Festival. They had an issue. They couldn't have one of their Yemeni artists who was meant to come. Because of visas, exactly. Yeah. Is it a problem for you guys?
Very much so. I mean, as we speak now, I'm still waiting for visas for one band that are based in Kenya. And, you know, it's a big sweat, you know. That's another addition on top of all the other stresses that you have is, you know, are these bands going to get their visas? Because it's not that the process is so different from what it is in the UK. It's that the infrastructure is not as good. So, for instance, one band I've been trying to contact via email for like over 2 weeks and, you know, they haven't got the infrastructure and they might have to go somewhere far to send an email. So you've got to take all that stuff into account. So logistically, it can be a nightmare to try and make it all happen and try and bring it all together. But you know, fingers crossed it'll all work out.
Yeah, fingers
it normally
crossed.
Does.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you very much. The festival is in less than 2 weeks, right?
Yes, 20th and 21st of June. So, yeah, the pressure's on at the moment. You know, I'm kind of working through it and trying to remain cool. But, yeah, believe me, it's a lot of stress and pressure.
Yeah, I can imagine. Yeah. Well, good luck with the festival this year. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Wow, that looks absolutely fantastic.
I've never been, you know.
Well, I've never been either.
I'm going to go.
Are you?
I'm taking the kids.
Okay, that sounds like a very good
well,
idea,
the fact
actually.
That he said there was stuff for children is brilliant.
Yeah, absolutely.
Have you ladies been to the African Oye Festival?
Well, yeah, I think I tend to go most years and I always bump into a bunch of friends and have a great time. And, you know, there's always somebody great playing. And, of course, the food, you know, goat curry, Jamaican goat curry, fantastic.
Lovely.
Beautiful. Oh, you must try it this year. It's fantastic.
Oh, you've got to try that. You've got to get one of the culture, haven't you? That's the point of these festivals.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Don't pressurise me. I
need some curry.
You can start off with jerk chicken.
Yeah. Jacquie, you've been to the festival. What, for people who haven't been before, what can they expect from it?
It is. As Paul said there, it's really about a big mix and pot of cultures, really. So it is a festival that's embraced by Liverpool's black community. And I think what's important is that we don't have massive, big festivals that just helicopter in and helicopter out. That actually they're owned and engaged with the community.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely. And this one is particularly one of them, really, that is community-based and also focuses internationally too. So I think everyone just goes gets an experience of being part of, feeling like they belong, having a great time, great food. You will meet loads of people. So as you walk around the park, yeah. you think it's going to take you 20 minutes to get round 2 hours later because you see so many people that you know. Yeah. It's just a great, great festival. So definitely go. Mm. I'm shocked that you haven't been before.
I know. Amazing. It's true. It's that thing, though, isn't it? You never really visit your own city because it's on your doorstep. We do take it for granted. Mm-hmm. And we are lucky we've got that many festivals. I mean, we've just had the River Festival.
We have. Yeah, that was...
I was in another city.
Oh, yes.
Either you girls get to the River Festival at all?
I didn't make it this year, did you, Manu?
And I didn't make it this year, but that's because we were decorating. But I know so many people from out of the city, friends of mine, who came up and said it was just fantastic. So we do generate amazing tourism based on the festivals.
Yeah. We do. And what we don't realise watching the African Oye video then, you don't realise how hard work it is, do you? I wouldn't have realised what you said about getting in contact with bands and it can take them 2 weeks and visas. They put a lot of work into making these festivals work, don't they? Are they worth it?
Absolutely worth it. I mean, God love them. The people who run these festivals, they must be tearing their hair out right up until the last minute. And the minute that it's over, they just must be like, wow, right. Yeah. And then planning the next one.
But the thing is, it's putting Liverpool on the map, but a brilliant spotlight. Absolutely. Because, you know, we're still turning things around for this city. And we've just had the Queen's in, which put the city in an amazing light.
Yeah.
The River Festival.
It was gridlock on the roads coming into Liverpool for
and the
three
river.
Queens, wasn't it?
Yeah. 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 But what's
doing
amazing?
A 3-point turn on the road.
I think what's amazing is how Liverpool accepts all these cultures and wants to celebrate the different cultures. Yes. Do you find that as a
place? Well, Liverpool's always been like that. Liverpool's like New York. We're a port. We've always been a port. And okay, we haven't been much of a port over the last sort of 40, 50 years, but it's coming back to life now. But that sort of sense of inclusion has always been here, and and long may it stay.
Yeah.
When people come into our city, the one thing they take away with them is, what's your favourite thing? The people. Yeah. It's the people. Yeah. And it is the
And
people.
They're talking about people from all the different cultures in Liverpool as well, aren't they?
Yeah. Yeah.
Everyone accepts each other. Everyone wants to celebrate each other. You see, as you said, you go down to the Africa Oye Festival, you get involved with everyone. I'm sure you meet people from so many different cultures who just want to get together and have fun. Is that what it's like?
Oh, yeah. Well, last year particularly, it was good because, I'm a member of one of these Facebook groups, Eric 77, and it's all the people who used to go to the Eric's Club back in the day in 1977. God, I'm that old. but we arranged to all meet at a certain place, and actually the guy was talking about Trenchtown then, and Trenchtown is a friend of mine who has one of these mobile cantinas, and this is the goat curry that I'm going to press upon you. But it was great to all get together again and rehash the old days whilst seeing all the new stuff that was going on.
Mm. I suppose it must be good for the guys from Eric's to see, how that started and the influence that's had on this city and the festivals.
Yes.
That have, piggybacked almost on the back of that.
Absolutely.
Because they were the start of it, weren't they?
Yeah, that was the beginning of the revolution for Liverpool.
Yeah, absolutely. Some of the bands that came out of Eric's, this is going right over your head, isn't it?
I've heard of Eric's. I have heard
the Stranglers and everything. Yeah, but the Sex Pistols, the Stranglers.
No, the Who was a separate band.
I know the Who. I do know. I'm just not sure I was around.
You could see a band for £2. It was fantastic.
Oh, not nowadays. Not nowadays.
It's murder trying to get a concert ticket out and a festival ticket. I mean, Glastonbury sells like that. And Creamfields sells, doesn't it?
Well, they do. They're just getting bigger and bigger.
Yeah, which is great, obviously, for Creamfields, because Creamfields is homegrown in this city.
Yes.
Cream started here. Now we're at Creamfields, which is global.
Yeah.
They tour to Ibiza, another massive place for festivals.
Yes.
There's so many.
Well, there are so many, but are you ladies planning on going to anyone in particular or a couple this summer that you've got your eye on going?
Definitely for us, it'll be Africa Oye. Definitely. And I think that's probably it for us, because you were saying before about New York. I'm married to a New Yorker and we're doing a house swap this year. Whereas his relatives are coming to live in our house and they're going to get the experience of America, and we're going over to America and going to have the whole summer over there. So we're going to do a cultural swap.
Compare the New York festivals to Liverpool festivals.
So we'll be pointing our New York relatives to some of the festivals that take place during August.
Yeah. August is Creamfields. This weekend we've got Farm Feast.
Yes, loads going on.
There's the Bombed Out Church. They've got a free event on Friday night at the Garage.
International Music Fest.
All over Sefton Park, and free as well. That's what the beauty of it. So many are free. What other city does that? Do they do that in New York, free festivals?
Not that I've been to, but I'm sure they will do a few. But I think we're pretty hot on doing the freebies. I think we're great at that.
Yeah, the River Festival was free. Craig Charles, Rebecca Ferguson, both Liverpool-born and bred. You saw them for free.
Why are they free, do you think? Is it because they want us to get engaged in them, or because we've got the money to do it? What's the benefit?
If we've got the money to do it when they put it on, but they know they're going to generate so much income to the city, and it's bringing the tourism in. That's going to make the revenue, isn't it?
The small businesses that are involved within the festivals, they'll have their stands there. Yeah. You know, there'll be somebody selling hippie gear, somebody else telling fortunes, and somebody else selling food. And there's so much that it's going to it helps with individuals as well as the larger organisations.
Yeah. It's all about the music, isn't it? Yeah. And talking of music, we're going to have our own superstar singing after the break, our very own Miss Jennifer Jewell, who's just sang for the mayor, no less.
Yes.
So join us after the break to hear our little songbird. Welcome back. So our songbird here, Jennifer, you love music, I love music.
I do.
If you could sing at any festival, because we've been talking a lot about festivals, which one would it be?
Obviously, the major. Is it going to be in our city or a
national festival?
I think I'd
go
global,
girl. Go global.
I think I'd go for Glastonbury. Just really? For, I've never been to. I'm so not a music festival person either, just because I'm simply not a fan of Portaloos. So I've never been to a festival, but that for me, every time you see it on TV, it just looks phenomenal. I get so much support, and it's a really respected musical festival. So I'd say that in our city, I've already performed at Liverpool Pride a couple of times.
Fantastic.
So that's a big one for me. I was delighted to do that.
That's on again soon, isn't it? Liverpool Pride.
It is. Yeah, it's coming up this summer. Other than that, the River Fest that was on this week looked fantastic. Yeah. So maybe next year go for that one.
Maybe.
Just selling myself here to the festival. but that's probably it. But yeah, I do love music. And
doesn't it make you feel good?
Yes, it does make you feel good. And actually, it was a survey released, wasn't there, to say Oxford have released a survey to say that music has a beneficial impact on our physical and our mental well-being. Would you ladies agree with that? You're both
definitely yes.
Obviously, big festival fan.
Is this when I sing?
No, when you sing, it has a negative effect.
I've got the voice of an angel. Weeping.
She wants it back.
Do we agree with that, Lee? Have you got anything in particular, Jacquie, that you do when you're not feeling your best or when you want to be lifted a little bit? Have you got anything specifically music-wise that you go to?
Definitely, your choice of Spotify playlists. You have one for every mood, depending on what's going on. But yeah, Spotify. And I think this city's got some great choirs as well in the city. There's one called Big Love Sister, another one called Raucous Caucus Recovery Chorus, and they're amazing.
What?
Raucous Caucus Recovery Chorus.
Love that.
That's
and they're
brilliant.
A choir full of people recovering from drug and alcohol problems, and they perform all over the city. So amazing choirs that we've got, and they're very uplifting to people's moods.
Well, that's great, isn't it? Because to be involved in a choir, you don't have to be a great singer, do you? Because a lot of people love, you can join. You're in. A lot of people love to sing, don't they, and express themselves, but they think, oh, I've not got a good voice. But is that something they can go along to and get involved in anyway?
Yeah, absolutely. It's just about expression. I think really the theme of what we've talked about today is all about being part of, belonging, and being in part of a choir is about belonging. And, and I think, particularly for people in early recovery, belonging is something that they really want. So to go to a choir
this
is great.
This city was built on music, though. We had the original boy band after all, didn't we? Them Fab Four.
And they could play those.
But one
Cat. Yeah, come on,
Cat. Oh, for me, well, if I'm feeling a bit out of sorts, and all my friends know, the first thing I reach for is disco music.
Yeah.
And I will do the Bee Gees, doing the hustle
disco
and everything.
Dancing.
Oh, yeah, all this kind of thing. Everything.
Why does it make you feel like?
It's like a moving meditation. I can't sit still and meditate. I've tried, I've been down to the Buddhist center. I've just still goes on in my head all the time. But if I start to move, then something just feels free within me and I let go of all my stresses and strains.
So it's medically proven now, or scientifically proven, same kind of thing.
Yeah.
So, it's all releasing endorphins. It's exercise, exercise is good for you.
Yeah,
so if you're singing along, you can't help but, shake your shimmy and get a bit of show me love on, and you're there.
What do you think choirs sing?
Whatever they want to sing.
Show me love.
Listen, if I was in a choir, handbag on the floor, I'd be there giving it. boxes.
All the choirs in the pool, but I'm like, don't let her in.
This is what? Me without drinking as well.
Gosh. What I was going to say about the choir point, because I think that's a fantastic point, actually, is you've got the support of other people. And as you say, when people are coming out of recovery, how key is the support of other people?
Totally. We have a phrase in recovery circles that says, I can't, but we can. So everything should be about doing things as a community, as a group of friends, so that you feel like you belong. So in a choir, you might feel like, oh, I can't sing, I couldn't sing a solo, but I could get in there with a group of people and feel supported and held, and all those voices kind of meld together, and that's what works.
Mm. Community spirit, isn't it, almost? Yeah. Family.
Yeah, totally.
People often say that, don't, and it does sound like a cliche, but, you know, we all feel like we're a family, and that seems to be what's coming across when you're talking about these choirs and the groups that you work with. They work together so well that they are almost a family, staying together and building each other up, which is what families do, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it's what families are meant to do. But unfortunately, some of us come from families that didn't do that, and that's often why people end up in, you know, various addiction treatment centres over the years. But that's what we try to do afterwards, is recreate a different type of family for them, so they have a better experience, what we call a corrective family experience for themselves.
Yeah. Well, family doesn't have to be blood, does it?
No, not at all. No, family's about being there for each other. Yeah. And that's a great way. Have you got a certain musical thing you like to do?
Well, do you know me? You know I like my DJs. I love my DJ music, DJ mixes. So I do love my dance music. And I don't mean necessarily show me love.
Although that is a favourite.
It is a favourite. I'm a big fan of Derek Hay, Greg Wilson, Ashley Beadle, which do lots of different mixes. I like that. But I also like my chill out music.
So your one thing is listening to music?
It doesn't have to necessarily be fast.
Okay.
You know, I love London Grammar. Massive fan of London Grammar. Right. And that's not known for, although it has been remixed. That's just beautiful and really, you know, melodic.
Would you not want to get into a bit of DJing yourself then?
No, because I wouldn't be able to dance.
Ah, so the dancing is the key, there you go.
It's the dancing. I don't even really dance. I kind of just stand there, put my finger in there like that.
It's dancing?
Kind of.
Yeah. Oh, but before we do finish this chat, Liverpool is a massive, massive city for music. We have said it once before. Is that why these music festivals really do hit home with Scousers?
Yeah, I think so. And also in terms of tourism, isn't it? It's why so many people come from overseas to sample everything here, because of, you know, the Beatles history, Merseybeat, all of that. Liverpool's kind of diverse history in terms of all the black music that went on before the Beatles. So I think people want to come and just be part of that.
Wow. We've got our own musical legend here, Jennifer. You might know her from Everton. We know her as the amazing Jennifer Jewell. She's about to get up and sing us our very own little song.
Those walls I built, baby, they're tumbling down. They didn't even put up a fight, they didn't even make a sound. I found a way to let you in, but I never really had a doubt. Standing in the light of your halo, I got my angel now. It's like I've been awakened, every rule I had you break. It's the risk that I'm taking. I ain't never gonna shut you out. Everywhere I'm looking now, I'm surrounded by your embrace. Baby, I can see your halo. You know you're my saving grace. You're everything I need and more. It's written all over your face. Baby, I can see your halo. I pray you won't fade away. I can see your halo, your halo, halo, halo. Hit me like a ray of sun, burning through my darkest night. You're the only one that I want, and I'm addicted to your light. I swore I'd never fall again, but this one you feel like falling. Gravity can't pull me back to the ground again. It's like I've been awakened. Every rule I had, you're breaking. Yeah, yeah. The risk that I'm taking, I ain't never gonna shut you out. Everywhere I'm looking now, I'm surrounded by your embrace. Baby, I can see your halo. You know you're my saving grace. You're everything I need and more. It's written all over your face. Baby, I can see your halo. I pray you won't fade away. And I can see your halo. Yeah, halo, halo. I can see your halo. Oh, I can see your halo. Yeah, halo. Yeah, halo. Oh, halo. Halo.
Jennifer Jewell, isn't she amazing?
Oh, thank you very much.
Oh, brought a tear to my tiny tears.
Oh, there she goes again. Oh, thank you so much.
So, all we've got to say is thanks to our guests.
Yes, fabulous guests, Cathy, and of course to Jacquie as well. And we're going to take a little bit of a break, aren't we, for a few weeks?
We are having, I think, back end of July, we're going to be back on with a bigger and better set. So, we'll see you then.
See you then.
Don't forget to keep in touch with us on social media.